Nope.
Keep it going, baby.
Hello, welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Episode 2, Pizza Girl. Jean Kyoung Frazier. Yes? I got a nod of approval. This is an audio podcast. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
And I'm your man, Steve Harvey. It's time to play Fast Money.
Today's crime, impersonation.
Stop trying. No.
I've never.
Stop trying to guess, predict, whatever, undermine my crime. You'll never be able to do it. And if you guessed it, I would just change it at the end anyway. So don't do it. Cut it out.
I thought that the crime might be thematically relevant.
Nope. It's not. Today's crime, murdering Joey for taking my bit.
It does. It does feel, that one feels on topic, though. That feels on brand. But we're here to talk about Pizza Girl, book two of our Processing Pain, the ways we've hurt people and how we've been hurt chunk.
I wish that we didn't commit to that as a
title. We don't have to call it
that. As a description for that, because it's like, feels too heavy.
It is pretty heavy. The first book was extremely heavy, and this is pretty heavy.
This book is surprisingly heavy, given the
art.
Cover art.
Yeah.
Yeah, which, describe the cover art.
So the cover art, she actually, like, I scrolled through the acknowledgements, and, like, sometimes they're, like, really fun, sometimes they're just like this one, which is more like...
This one particularly I actually really liked, because I read the acknowledgements, too, and I really liked it. I thought it was sweet.
Jean talks about how, like, this is, like, her favorite artist, and, like, this is the first book he ever did, and she thought it was really cool, but it's, like, this kind of neon-soaked, sort of looks like an 80s movie, where a big slice of pizza, dripping cheese and pickles and pepperoni, and there's a car, and there's just, like, a face that's, like, the L.A. skyline, and there's a palm tree, and checkerboards for some reason.
Yeah, it's very much like an airbrushed shirt that you would buy on the boardwalk in Venice, or Point Pleasant, New Jersey, or...
Anywhere in between.
No. It's got, like, serious boardwalk vibes.
Yeah.
You're not going to buy it in Ames, Iowa, probably.
You might. Maybe not, though. But, Bob, what's Pizza Girl about?
It is about a 18-year-old woman who is a pizza delivery girl, and she's pregnant.
Yeah. And her life changes forever when a middle-aged woman calls to order pizza with pickles on it, and she goes there and falls in love with this woman.
Yeah, falls in love is a interesting way to think of it.
I think she falls in love with the idea of this woman, or the idea of another life, or...
Right. She's looking for a escape route. She's looking for someone who would radically change her life from where she is right now.
Yeah. Because where she is right now, she's working, she's a high school graduate, ostensibly, who does not know what she wants to do with her future, and is working a presumably minimum wage job, is pregnant, as mentioned, and living at her mom's house with her boyfriend. Her dad died. She's not doing well with that. What's interesting about this book, I think, especially compared to, or in similarity to Death in Her Hands from last episode, they're not unreliable narrators, but because we're in their head, their actions seem far more justified. But, like, a lot of what she's doing here is, like, wildly destructive and, like, irresponsible. It feels less so because we're in her head.
Yeah, I read some reviews of this book on, not like in The Guardian or anything like that, but like just like, you know, the type of reviews.
I don't want to hear it.
The type of reviews that you see on Goodreads and things. And a lot of the people who were like, 2 stars, 1 star, couldn't finish, a lot of what they were saying was, unlikable narrator, I'm with her to a certain point, and I feel for her, but I can't support the danger that she's putting her unborn child through and stuff like that, which is like an interesting way to have to read a book, right? Like this idea that you have to find the main character moral. You have to find them someone who has not like transgressed whatever your line of judgment from likable to not likable is.
Well, because I think there's something that I watch movies sometimes and I wish there was no conflict. I'm like, this would just be like a fun party movie. Like, let's have everybody just have a good time. And like, well, that's not storytelling. There's no conflict. There's no drama. You need something there. So I guess it's interesting to think that these people are like, I want my character to be wrong, to not be the one doing the wrongs or something. Or like the wrongs that I feel are justifiable, as opposed to like, while she's pregnant, drinking like multiple cases of beer and liquor and drinking and driving and all this irresponsible shit. And like, things like ignoring her mom and her boyfriend, who, like, for all intents and purposes, seem like, maybe too much so, like, the best support system she could possibly have in the situation.
Yeah. The thing that interests me about this, and the reason why I think that those people, the Goodreads people who are who like can't get into a book with an unlikable narrator, the reason why I think those people can basically fuck off is because like I found this character incredibly relatable, even though I'm 20 years older than she is.
Yeah, your mom age.
We'll get to that in a minute. I have never been pregnant. There's like a bunch of stuff, but like her right. specific circumstances are not relatable. But the way that she processes them and this idea of like being self-destructive and feeling like you're in prison, imprisoned by some of your own decisions, imprisoned by people who love you too much and you feel like
smothered.
Yeah. Like that's all like super real.
Yeah.
The world has enough people judging these kinds of characters. And, like, the reality is that these kinds of characters need a kind of empathy, both in fiction and in the real world. Like, they don't need to be loved so much as they need to be seen and acknowledged, like, their circumstances. The idea of dismissing a character because they're unlikable is bonkers to me, especially a character like this that has so many reasons to root for her and so many reasons to want her to get through it. It's not like Don Draper or Walter White or something like that. Whereas, right. Like, those are, like, unlikable characters that have entered the mainstream and been lionized because they're, like, super badass or because they...
Yeah, there's a whole book about, like, difficult men. Like, Alan Sepinwall wrote about them and Tony Soprano. Like, we idolize these people who are, like, irredeemable in every way.
Yeah. Like, I think if you look at the book from a feminist perspective, the way people read or internalize the actions of the characters in this book in a way that they might not for Walter White or Don Draper comes because of like the expectations that we have of women to behave a certain way, to not fuck up in the way that we allow men to fuck up, or right. because she's given this immense responsibility of growing this thing inside of her body that she might not even really want. Like her boyfriend in the book, Billy, is great.
Yeah.
He seems like a wonderful person that is trying his best and loves her. And part of the reason why we're angry at her is because she doesn't appreciate that enough.
Right. He's a high school baseball player who apparently seemed to have the talent to get a full ride to a college based on athletics. But we find out that he has a full ride to USC based on academics. You know, it just seems like he is. And he is described by the narrator and by sort of indirectly by the mom as like America. The mom was so overjoyed when her 18-year-old daughter said she was pregnant because like that meant this guy was going to stick around. And for an immigrant to America, like a first generation immigrant, to see her daughter seemingly to a certain extent like lock down this like all-American boy, I can't imagine anything better. Like she is now part of America. I don't know if he's described as good looking, but like you picture like just like a handsome dude who's like smart and talented and like will do anything to be a good dad and like drops out of USC before he even goes to like stay home and take care of her and is like great with the mom. And like there's a reason why he's perfect to a fault, right? Because it's like if there was any mark against him, it would be easy to kind of be like, well, yeah, I don't like him because of that or whatever. But like I think he's bulletproof for a reason, probably.
Yeah, I think it's framed so that we accept that he is sacrificing all of this stuff almost to complicate our relationships with the narrator, who until the very end of the book doesn't have a name. She exclusively goes by Pizza Girl,
which is interesting because it's all both her name and this nickname are only via the woman she falls in love with.
Right.
Nobody else calls her Pizza Girl.
Right.
Nobody else calls her anything, really.
Right. Yes. So, but we frame Billy in the things that he's given up to be with her and yeah. to raise this child. He's given up like what seems like a really bright future. Again, because we accept this idea of men sacrificing their futures for children as being this like great tragedy,
noble.
This noble trauma that this guy is willing to go through. And oh my God, he's such a good guy. But then like we don't even really consider. And I think this is on Jean Kyoung Frazier's part. I think she's doing this on purpose. We don't even consider the like immense loss of potential for the narrator.
Society just assumes like, of course you would stop everything. Like,
yeah,
being a mom is the most important thing you could possibly do.
Right. Yeah. Even if you're 18. Yeah. Even though we've like ascribed a certain amount of shame to that.
Yeah.
And she has to deal with some of that throughout the book. But like we don't look at what she's doing as sacrifice, whereas we look at what Billy's doing as sacrifice, because it's like framed in this labor position right? So this is something that, like, I think is sort of important for this book, is to think of it from a quote-unquote Marxist perspective. Marxism being the examination of material conditions of the text and how they influence, how those material conditions influence the reality of that world. There are a couple of different things, I think, that influence that with regards to our main character, right? Number one is that the person that the main character desires mostly refers to her exclusively as Pizza Girl, which is something that we just mentioned. But that's, like, cute, kind of. Like, it's like it's almost like, you know, referring to the girl as her last name and, like, right, kind of a chummy,
yeah,
like, hey, Pizza Girl, what's going on with you? But it also uses labor to define her humanity, right? Like, she is her job.
Sure.
And it never pushes their relationship beyond transactional, right? Pizza Girl brings her a pizza. Jenny Hauser?
Yeah.
Is that her name?
Yep.
Is there a famous person named Jenny Halzer?
I don't know.
I think there is.
I'll look that up.
But so they're, because their relationship is transactional, like, Pizza Girl comes when Jenny calls. Jenny knows her exclusively as Pizza Girl. Like, she's defined through her labor, which is this pizza delivery person is something that we don't generally think of as respectable in modern society. Now, the other major definition of our narrator is motherhood, which is, like, obviously, like, the great unpaid labor of our time.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that, like, a quote-unquote job defines the respectability for men, so too does motherhood for women. No matter how, like, that's archaic, but I think to a certain degree it's true because shitheads make it true, right? And the narrator feels incredibly trapped in both of these worlds, both in the world of that transactional labor with Jenny Hauser and the non-transactional but, like, unpaid labor world of motherhood.
Well, she's defined by two things that she doesn't want to be defined by.
Yes, exactly. And she just wants to run away. She wants to break the chains of that pizza girl relationship with Jenny because she wants to be much more with Jenny. She wants to be a mother to his child.
Right.
That's what's interesting, is that she wants to mother Jenny's kid and
right,
not her own kid.
It feels like, I mean, one of the biggest conflicts in this book, which isn't in the present, even though it is in the present, but it's between her and her dead father, right?
Mm-hmm,
because
sure,
he was a drunk, and he was, I think it's hard to say whether he was a good or a bad dad.
No, he's a bad dad.
Bad dad. It does, to a certain extent, feel like the thing she wants to be most in this world is her dad.
Yeah.
Well, or specifically, a man who is able to have nothing asked of him.
Right, which, like, I think, again, goes a little bit back to Billy and that relationship, right? Which is this idea that, like, in some ways the coolest thing in the world is the bad dad. Right?
Yeah.
Like, the dad who's just like, fuck it. Like, let's go to Disney World while I'm drunk driving.
And I'm taking you out of school to go to Disney
yeah,
World.
Yeah, and it's like, that, like, sounds fun.
Yeah, until he falls asleep on the freeway.
Yeah, it sounds fun until he's dead.
Yeah.
Until he's
mm-hmm,
made everyone around him miserable. The least cool person is the person that follows rules, the person that, like, makes you follow rules. The parent that makes you eat your vegetables is the parent that, when you're a kid, you're like, I hate you. And the parent that is drunk and takes you to Disney World is the parent that you love. And then you're 35 and you go, oh, shit, I had it wrong the whole time.
Yeah.
It should have been the other way
right,
around.
There is a Jenny Halsey, but she's a fictional character from The Mummy, the Tom Cruise Mummy, in the Dark Universe.
Oh, yeah, that must have been what I was thinking.
Played
about,
by Annabelle Wallace. That's the closest
yeah,
I can come to.
That's
that,
the one. That's what I was thinking.
I know that the Mummy lives rent-free in your head,
I was thinking,
right?
Yeah, I was thinking of Jenny Halsey, the character played by someone in the Tom Cruise version of The Mummy.
Yeah. There's not a day that goes by where you don't mention The Mummy in one way or another.
I was afraid that it was going to be like, oh yeah, Jenny Halsey, she's this person from this very specific fetish pornography that you've just revealed.
The pickle fetish.
Yeah, let's talk pickles on pizza. What do you think about that?
So the reason why, I guess, she keeps ordering... So we're in this... the head of this pizza girl... Jenny is made to seem to be the greatest, like, the most laudable, like, the envy, the idyllic. But when we first are introduced to her, what's enviable is that she's got a long-ass ponytail.
Hell yeah.
But she seems like, she seems like an okay mom at first, but she's kind of a mess. She's frazzled. We find out she's not a good mom. She doesn't really
Wait, I walk that back. Why? But I don't, what's the evidence that she's not a good mom?
She leaves her son to go see a movie.
Hey, you gotta do that sometimes.
I guess. I think, well, she thinks that she's a bad mom.
Yeah, okay, which I think is the case of a lot of parents, right?
Sure,
a lot of parents who are being driven crazy by their kids think that they're bad parents, Because they've been guilted into thinking that they're bad parents, because they think that they should have to do everything, but that's, you know.
So there's something interesting that she's presented as kind of a frazzled lead in a sitcom, like a Zooey Deschanel type almost, where she's like, I can't get anything right, but like, yeah. I'm still adorkable or whatever, right? Again, I think there could have been a lot of, because it feels like Pizza Girl admires or envies or something a lot of the people she delivers pizza to, or at least a few. Yeah,
sure.
There's like the hot couple that's always boning that we find out later he's beating the shit out of her and like broke her arm and like made her vomit blood. It's just like, oh, things aren't what they seem. But it seems like there's a bunch of different ways that this could have gone where she could have fallen head over heels because she wanted an escape from her current life, right? She goes to Jenny's house because she calls and this woman's like, I need a pizza with pickles on it. And nowhere else does that. And she's like, there's a place next door. I'll figure it out. I'll come there. And then they just sort of become this like what feels like a torrid romance. But if we're in Jenny's head, it's just like this weird girl who comes and gives me a pizza and like we hang out for a little bit. I think there's something really fascinating. Again, going back to like Magda last time,
yeah,
in Death in Her Hands, in her head, she's the best detective in the room. To the rest of the town, she's a smelly old lady who lives alone and is like kind of going crazy. The relationship, the dynamic between Pizza Girl and Jenny is like one of like forbidden love. I think if it's Jenny, because we find out by the end of the book, spoilers for the end of the book, that she's in a loving marriage, that she's in a great, like an idyllic marriage. Mm-hmm. Like it's the kind of thing that like Pizza Girl could have with Billy if she accepted that. She's like, no, I need to save her from this, because like she only sees a picture of Jenny's husband as like, there's nothing good about that man.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting too. Cause when we see Jenny and Jenny's frazzled and Jenny is having a hard time dealing with Adam, the child, and Jenny, needs to go to the movies on her own, mm-hmm, to clear her head and to sort of hit the reset button. Mom wise, her husband's not anywhere. We don't see him at all. He's completely
absent. We don't know where he's the entire time. No.
And again, I think this is a trick of the text. While we're possibly judging Jenny for in much the way that Jenny is judging herself for being a bad mother,
right,
it doesn't really occur to us to judge the father, right? To think like, oh, this guy's a shitty dad. But that is entirely Pizza Girl's job. That's what Pizza Girl does for us, right? She jumps in and is like, she's thinking like, what's the deal with this guy?
Well, because society has basically been like, oh, he's out earning. He's the breadwinner. He's allowing her to have this like crazy kind of lifestyle where she doesn't have to work. Like, right, he's doing the noble thing.
So again, the value here is placed on labor. But unpaid labor is unappreciated. The unpaid labor of motherhood is completely unappreciated by the characters of this book.
Which then factors into the end where his job is what shows Pizza Girl that their marriage is good. Toward the end of the book, Jenny says, oh, we're moving tomorrow. And Pizza Girl, because this is her soulmate to a certain extent, is like, how can they only give you one day to move? She's like, no, we've known for a while.
Yeah.
Come on, dummy. Like, what are
you... Yeah. Like, I got pizza. Nah, I haven't had pizza delivered in a really long time. But, like, my pizza man would never know if I was moving. It just wouldn't happen.
No. But also, you're not, like, hanging out with your pizza man and, like, falling in love. I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. But
one time, this pizza guy came to my door. This was years ago. I was at my parents' house, and he was delivering pizza. It was this kid named Dan that I went to high school with, and he goes, hey, man, what the fuck is up? And I was just like, why is the pizza man cursing at me?
Was he just excited to see you?
I guess so. And then I gave him a 20 for the pizza. Or maybe it was, I think I gave him a 50 for the pizza, and he just tried to walk away. And I was like, Dan, no, Dan, not all of that money is yours. And I had this weird, like, little thing where with this kid from my high school that was trying to steal money from me.
Today's crime is petty theft.
It's the last time I'm going to tell you to stop trying to guess the crime.
Jenny's like, we're moving tomorrow, and Pizza Girl's befuddled. She's like, well, I just wouldn't, like, we're just friends. Like, it, you know, whatever. Thought didn't cross my mind. Like, I'm not telling you everything that's going on in my life, whatever, right? Also, I'm saying I'm a bad mom. Maybe I'm also a bad friend. Like, maybe I think of myself as a bad friend. Who knows? Whatever.
I mean, she is a bad friend.
Oh, yeah. But, like, I also don't know that she knows that she's being a bad friend.
Right.
Because that's the whole thing. Like, her friendship, if she would even call that, I guess she would, because they go out to dinner. They go out to diners and stuff, right? Like, her friendship with Pizza Girl is not at all filling the same itch, fulfilling the same need, scratching the same itch, whatever, as Pizza Girl's friendship with Jenny is doing. Like, yes. It's a very imbalanced power dynamic.
Well, they go to a, what do they go to? It's like a,
it's it's like Al-Anon, but for like pregnant, because there's budget cuts, which is very funny. It's just like, it used to be one group that was pregnant women and one like new moms, but now they just have to be in the same group because there's not enough money.
Yeah, so you have...
Which again is probably testament to like, oh, those women can just figure it out. Like, we don't need to spend all that money on two different... They're all the same kind of thing.
Yeah, and it's a group that... it's a church that the narrator is familiar with because of Al-Anon, right? And because of...
Which is where she met Billy.
She met Billy
at... No, not Al-Anon. It was the dead family members thing.
Okay.
Because Billy's parents died.
Right.
And her dad died. And they met there. And they fell in love there. And then, like, shortly thereafter, she got pregnant.
Okay. But they went to high school together, though, right?
I don't think so.
Okay. This is something. This is something that I may have missed. I thought that they had
gone to high school. I'm pretty sure. I don't know that it matters one way or the other, really.
Right.
I'm reasonably confident that they met at this grief thing. And that's the same church or the same area or whatever where she has the mom thing.
Okay.
She moves to Bakersfield, but she's like, here's my new address, which I don't know why she gives the pizza girl her new address.
Because she wants her to send her a photo of the baby.
Email address.
Eh.
Anyway.
It's 2011. Not everyone had email back then.
I did like that pizza girl throws her phone and like it's like a flip, like it breaks. Like, I was just picturing like an iPhone or something, and then like the battery pops out. I'm like, oh. I guess it could be like an Android.
Yeah, this is a period piece. Why? What up with that?
Well, that's what I asked you, and you think, and it's what I would have guessed. That is probably when the author, when Jing Kyoung Frazier was 18 or so.
Yeah, that's my guess too. Because I think that if I were writing, and I were writing about an 18-year-old, I would be recalling my memories from when I was 18 instead of trying to imagine what an 18-year-old right now was like, which is a completely different world right now because it's everything has kind of changed. And also, it allows the book to avoid certain. Social media traps, I guess.
We have not mentioned this in the first episode, but you and I, with another friend who just had a baby, shout out to him, he and his wife, we're rewatching The X-Files, and there's so many episodes of The X-Files are like Seinfeld that I'm watching, and just like, if they had like actual cell phones, like none of this would have happened.
Yeah.
That's just taking place modern day back then, but I think there's a reason people said things in the 90s, because like they can't figure out like how to get around the modern trappings of modern conveniences.
Well, I don't think any of the essential drama of this changes if you change the time period. This book could be taking place in the 1950s. Maybe it would actually be more acceptable in the 1950s.
I think there needs to be, I think a lot of the drama in this book needs to come from the fact that she is accessible via cell phone.
And yeah, right.
But, because I think we live in a society now where like, why didn't you text me back? Like, why didn't you text me back?
Yeah.
And like back then it's like, well, you know, I just was doing other things. I don't know. I don't really remember. But like if it's the 1950s, because so much of the drama here is Billy and the mom being like, we called you, why
sitting
didn't you answer?
Couch, yeah.
But like otherwise it's just, well, we didn't have a way to get in touch with you. And she's like, oh no, my car broke down. Like there's like her shitty excuses are more believable.
Yeah, but in 2011, it's like, didn't people still had iPhones in 2011?
Yeah.
It was still basically the same world that it is now.
So what are you saying about like the social media thing?
Oh, then? I think like if I were in the narrator's position now, I feel like
in a 2021 narrative,
you would be there would be a lot of like Instagram stalking and things like that, and trying to find that stuff. But that may have also my brain has time fever or something. I don't understand.
Well, like, Twitter was around in like 2008, 2009.
Sure was.
I don't know when, but like, and Instagram was around like 2012 at least, if not earlier. Again, I might just be getting the facts wrong too, but it's amazing how quickly you can find, like, based on like one, like a first name and like one bit of information, you can find people easily anywhere almost.
I think we maybe went down a hole here. That,
no, but I think it's interesting because like it is a kind of a quirk of the book.
Yeah.
As a period piece. It doesn't necessarily need to be. I don't know.
Let's talk a little bit about her actual job.
Well, I want to talk about at the end, because we still didn't find out. So she's moving because of her husband's, Jenny is moving because of her husband's job.
Yeah.
Pizza Girl thinks of it as she's being forced to move because of the job, but she then realizes after she breaks in, we'll get to this again, breaks into the new house, that she moved for her husband, not because of her husband. So like the relationships are defined by and measured by jobs and success and career advancement, but through the men, right?
Yeah, right.
So. But Pizza Girl's job. Go ahead.
So she works at a pizza place, obviously, and she has this relationship with her coworker, Daryl, who is a gay black man who is in a relationship with a guy named Carl who's treating him poorly. And she has a manager that has one great scene where he's kind of a dick to her, where he's like, you like my office?
What do you think of my wallpaper? Yeah.
She's like, I like the wallpaper. And he's like, you shouldn't have an opinion about my wallpaper. Next time you have an opinion about next time you see my wallpaper, you're fired.
Which is crazy. But also effective.
Yeah. Her relationship with Daryl is the sort of primary social relationship in the text that exists outside of her family and outside of Jenny, right? He's the only person that she really talks to, the only person that she really seems to get along with. He is offering to be there for her. He refuses to buy her beer. He seems like a good friend. He tells her...
So he's probably a little older than her, is what we're led to believe. If he can buy beer...
Yes, right. So he's at least 21.
Does that make him one of the only people in the book who's a bigger fuck-up than she is? Because if he's 21 and working a shitty pizza job and she's 18, like, I don't... Like, you know, societally, maybe? Or is that not... Or do you think that's not relevant?
Well, I don't think... I mean,
I don't know if that matters. I don't know if that's
a yeah. I wouldn't put it in those terms. I don't think that like and I don't think that this is what you're necessarily saying. But like I wouldn't define people who are like 21 working at pizza places as fuck ups, right?
No, even though she defines herself as that as an 18-year-old, especially specifically when former classmates come in,
right?
And she doesn't have an answer to any of their questions.
Which I felt that. I mean, I was in like 2008, 2009. I was working as a cashier at Rite Aid in my hometown because I had just moved back from Los Angeles and I was just a cashier.
Do you want to put context around how old you were? Because people don't know how old you are.
In 2008, I was, you do the math.
25?
1983, 2008, 25. I was 25. A guy came in who was a guy that I knew in high school and he was a police officer. And I was just like, oh, and I just like started pouring sweat. I was just like, I can't believe that like people are witnessing me at this job.
I thought you were gonna say because he was going to identify this episode's crime, but... Which I will not guess.
Dead also, air. That's also, what you get.
There is a guilt where you're like, I'm not going anywhere with my life. But it's also like, you're 25. Like, you're dumb for a long time. Like, everybody's dumb for a long time. Yeah. I don't think it's a knock. Like, I've never known how to answer the question, like, in a job interview. Like, what are you going to be in 5 years? Like, I have no idea. The world's crazy.
Yeah. I don't know if this is... I've never done it, so I could be completely wrong here. But delivering pizza sounds like a cool job to me.
I have friends who love doing it in high school.
Yeah, it just seems like fun. Like, you drive around. A big component of this book is her listening to her iPod.
And the volume at which she listens to her iPod. Yeah. It's either low enough so she can think or loud enough to blot out the world.
Which I think sort of defines an era of life, too, right? Like, when I was, like, you know, iPod, headphones in, wandering the streets with the music so loud that I couldn't think straight, like, that really defines an emotional state. That is, I think, probably located to age, chronological age, right?
I think it's also a benefit of 2011, because, like, if you throw your phone, there goes your iPod.
Yeah. I have a 120-gig iPod that I still fuck with. Daryl thinks that they're really good friends, right? She's very clear that they're not friends at a certain point toward the end of the book, that he's just, like, a guy that she works with. And it's very painful for him to hear that.
Is that before she gets fired? Because she sees him again at the grocery store.
Yeah,
no,
it's before she gets fired, yeah.
Okay. And that's what's interesting about the dynamics of all these relationships is because we're in... Like, I never really got the sense that they were, like, super friend. Like, just, like, a work friend. Mm-hmm. And we don't know... Like, the same way that we think that Jenny and her are, like, powerful friends, it's like they're not really because Jenny doesn't feel the same way, but, like, we don't really get in Daryl's head at all.
Yeah.
We know so powerfully little about Daryl. Is it Daryl or is it his boyfriend who has sex with a checkout girl at the beginning?
That's Carl.
Daryl's
boyfriend, yeah.
So, like, that's kind of all we know about Daryl. Like, outside of the confines of the pizza place, we don't know Daryl at all. Like, she never calls Daryl, I don't think, right? It's just, like, he's a work friend.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's weird, like, because that's something that, as you get older, becomes more and more important. Because when you get older, friends kind of... fade away because most of them have their own, they start families, they have jobs that take up an enormous amount of their time, they don't have that much time to do things on weekends, so like a lot of the fucking around that you do is just with like work friends, people that you like spend a lot of time with but not on purpose, people that you're forced into this relationship with that you might not even like if you weren't sharing the same space with, but you develop these intense relationships.
What I think is interesting is that we never get a sense that Pizza Girl's ever had friends at all.
That's right, yeah.
One way or the other. Like, she might be the most popular girl or not. Like, she knows people from high school, but, like, everybody knows people from high school. It does kind of feel like maybe she was a bit more of a wallflower because, like, she's like, you know, nothing hurts more than when people come in, they don't recognize me.
Well, and she talks about crushes that she had in high school, right? That were unreciprocated crushes on girls, which her sexuality is interesting, too, because it is, like, super fluid, right? Mm-hmm. Obviously, she's attracted to Jenny. Jenny is
married to a man,
but Jenny also kisses her back. Like they share a kiss.
Yep.
That it seems pretty intense.
I think that's something interesting about more modern writing. Cause like in the first like 10 or 15 pages, Daryl is defined as a gay man. Like, he has a boyfriend, mm-hmm. and then, like, his boyfriend had sex with a woman. I'm just like, wait, but, like, that's just life. Like, that's just normal, right?
Yeah.
Like, I think there's something that is very modern and honest about a thing that's probably always been going on, but it's just much more acceptable or yeah. whatever, or just more, like, common. Like, that's not a crazy thing. It just, Daryl's attracted to women, too. Like, he talks about that, too, right? Mm-hmm. So he just, you know, but men are the only one who can ruin his life. That's how we know he's, that's how he knows he's gay.
It's a good line.
Because he, yeah. He finds women beautiful, but men are the only ones who can ruin his life, which is pretty good.
Yeah.
Can we talk about the one line, speaking of good lines, that you and I both loved?
Is it the bit where she is sharing the kiss with Jenny?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
So Jenny doesn't call at work. Pizza Girl goes over to her house just to be like, is she okay? And she's done this before. She's gone at like the middle of the night after a night shift and sees Jenny through the window, like rearranging her refrigerator. Because suburbia, I guess, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The next Wednesday, because she always calls on Wednesdays, the next Wednesday she doesn't call. And so she goes over there and sees them getting home. Like, she parks outside their house for like 15 minutes or whatever. And she sees them getting home and the son looks very upset. And she like decides, like, I need to act. I need to help this situation, which is like way out of the bounds of like pizza delivery girl. And then this is when Jenny's like, I need to get out of here. Watch him for a while. And they have a good night, seemingly. He even cooks for her. Cooks is a strong word, but he makes food for her, gets food for her. And then Jenny comes home after the son's gone to bed, and then they just have this kiss on the couch. Like, not a lot, because, again, the narrative's not very long, and not a ton goes on, but, like, this is one of, like, the big, like, set pieces, kind of, right?
Yeah, it's a big moment.
Seconds pass without Jenny kissing me back. Seconds of she hates me. She doesn't feel my thoughts. A second more, and her lips were pressing against mine, even harder, and I wanted to take her to 7-Eleven. I'll get the cherry Slurpee, you get the Coke. We'll sip and kiss, and it'll be fruity soda perfection. Bask in that lamp store glow. You're beautiful, and I'll never make you cry. You'll pick up every phone call from me on the first ring.
Which is, like, that's great, because she's defining, like, a good relationship as the thing that she's not doing in her own personal relationship, right? Where she's just ignoring phone calls, ignoring text messages, but she's saying, like, that wouldn't be a problem with us. You would, and she's not saying I would pick up when you call on the first ring, saying you would pick up on my first, when I call you on the first ring.
Yeah.
So she's abdicating responsibility on answering the phone to the other person in the relationship.
But I think that's also implying that she would always pick up on the first ring anyway.
Maybe, yeah.
She just wants that in return.
Yeah.
But I think there's just something so beautiful and vivid and real and good about such a simple fantasy. Mm-hmm. Like, the phone call's a little bit bigger, but, like, let's just go get Slurpees and kiss and, like, taste the Slurpees. Like, that's just, like, some 18-year-old romance shit, right?
Yeah, with a woman who's 35 to 30 to 40, who probably doesn't see that romance as the same way. She was probably just looking at that kiss as, like, tension release from a very difficult day.
Yeah.
Well, there's a big ending.
There's a big ending. There's a crazy big ending.
That we should talk about. That sort of feels a little bit out of character for the book. It goes a lot bigger than...
Well, I think... So I do agree. I think that the book does a good job of getting to a point where that could be possible.
Well, okay. So maybe before going into that, we should talk about... from the beginning of the book to this ending, there is an acceleration of the narrator's self-destructiveness. She starts out by drinking 2 to 3 beers a night in a shed in the back of her house, a shed that her father used to drink in when he was still alive.
Yes.
And then that expands.
That she thought was this grand, like, I wonder what's out there, and it's just like a shitty TV in a chair and crushed up beer cans.
Yeah. As the book goes on, she's drinking more and more.
Yep.
She's stealing swigs of whiskey. She's drinking. Daryl is pours Bacardi in a soft drink at work, and she takes a swig of that. And more and more, she's getting drunker and drunker throughout the text, to the point where she's now standing outside of shopping plazas, asking people to go in and buy alcohol for her, which is a thing that 18-year-olds do all the time, but is a little more... People are a little more judgmental of when you're pregnant, when you're visibly pregnant.
What I thought was actually a really nice, honest moment is when the first, like, a woman buys it for the first time. She's like, I know you have your reasons. Just, like, I don't want to hear it. Like, don't try to lie to me. Just, like, I get it. Just, I don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
I'll help you out, but, like, I don't want to hear your story.
Yeah. Probably I've been in a bad circumstance, too, and it's actually painful to recount a story, right?
Yeah.
And when you feel like you need to, like, make excuses or something, it's like... Yeah, just don't bother.
Right.
And then that leads, this like accelerating self-destruction leads to her taking Billy's gun and driving to Bakersfield, which is where Jenny has moved.
Because Billy, so the thing is, like, Billy gets the gun because he seems to have a scumbag friend.
Yeah.
He's like, you know, whenever I need money, I just go rob an ATM. It's like, wait, what? And so he gives Billy a gun just in case, because he knows that Billy's been having a hard time. I guess Billy's probably like, it seems like this kind of guy is maybe like a Daryl type, or just like, we just talk about things at work or whatever. And he knows that Billy's going through a tough time, maybe at home or with his girlfriend or whatever. And, hey, do it, take a gun. And so she comes home early from work, and he's, like, staring, like, kind of taxi driver sort of style.
In the mirror.
Yeah. And she's like, what's going on? And then she takes the gun and goes.
It's the first kind of hint of Billy being, like, not necessarily the person that we think he is. Because, like, he's doing a whole, like, yeah, staring at himself in the mirror holding a gun. Like, that's defining him as someone that he is not, right? Like, holding a gun makes him feel more in control, makes him feel more masculine, makes him feel more like the person that he would have been had he not had to drop out of school and gone down this whole road of landscaping to support a family that he wasn't expecting.
Although I do get the sense that he does not like this new person. He's trying it on, right. But he doesn't like it the way it feels.
Right. But it's like, that might be his future. He might be a guy with a gun in the future. So she steals this gun from him, drives to Bakersfield. In the middle of the night. Gets drunk, drinks the whole way there. When she gets there, she busts open a bottle of wine, drinks that, goes into their bedroom.
Well, she goes into the son's bedroom and, like, just, like, checks in on him and, like, rubs his head, like, fingers through the hair.
Which is a callback to earlier when he had his head in her lap and she was brushing his hair like that. She goes in, looks at Jenny and her husband, James.
Well, because she earlier in the book pictures how they sleep. Mm-hmm. And she's like, he faces right, she faces left, back to back. Like, there's no love there.
Yeah.
And she walks in and they're, like, on each other.
Spooning, yeah.
Asleep.
Yeah. And so she's like, oh, shit, I have misjudged this whole thing. So she goes back out to the living room. And I think briefly you get the impression that she might shoot herself, right?
She points a gun at herself, yeah. And then just, like, wants to know what it's like. So she, like, points it at the ceiling and fires and there's no bullets in there. But it does feel like, oh, there's a lot of tension in this book. But there's nothing in the book that feels even remotely this tense until this thing. There's, like, a million different things that could go wrong. And none of them do. Like, she very easily could have left without and never gotten found out. Like, she comes back downstairs, then breaks open the bottle of wine, sits down, just gets drunk, you know, waving the gun around. But she could have left and gone back home and, like, nothing would have happened. But instead she, like, maybe contemplates suicide and then just is going to fire into the house where there's no bullets and then just, like, falls asleep and wakes up as she's getting thrown out of the house.
Yeah. So we have, like, a thing that in a worse book, I think, could feel like a sort of artificially violent or tense ending. But it works in this book because, like I said, the self-destruction is slowly cranked up.
Well, what I think is interesting about the way that this ends, too, is this ends the narrative. Then there's, like, a 30-page or something epilogue. But, like, this is the end of the story, which I think is a very kind of interesting way to end it. And there's, like, a good chunk, you know, like 10 or 15% of the book left. That's just what happens next.
But yeah. Why have an epilogue instead of a final chapter?
I don't know. But it doesn't even wrap up the story with Jenny, because she meets Jenny again. She sees Jenny again. Jenny follows her again.
Which is where we, in the parking lot, she says, hey, pizza girl. Pizza girl says, do you even know my name? And that's when she's finally named.
Yeah.
And she's named as their relationship is severed. Mm-hmm. So she sort of gains her humanity from no longer being pizza girl. She has a name.
Right. And they even joke about names, about, like, maybe I'll name my daughter this, maybe, like, your name, and maybe I'll name my daughter your name or whatever. And they're like, that's weird. Like, we don't don't do that.
Yeah, don't do that. They throw her mother, Pizza Girl's mother, a party. And it's revealed during this that Pizza Girl's mother is turning 37, which is how old I am right now. And so when I was reading it, I was like, I felt like someone had punched me in the sternum or something. Because it was just like, oh, shit, like, this is, like, how young this character is, mm-hmm. that she's the daughter of someone my age, who, yeah, had her when she was very young, obviously, but it's still, like, the idea that I would be the grandfather of
a newborn.
Yeah, of Pizza Girl's daughter is, like, put into perspective how young all of these characters are and how daunting it is for an 18-year-old to have a baby.
I think it's another trick, maybe, that narrative plays. Because, like, we think of just what a mom is, and she's, like, a good mom. Like, she's a very loving, doting mom. She could be, like, Jenny's older than her. Jenny turns 39, or she's about to turn 39, right? So, like,
yeah,
she's essentially, not directly, but to an extent, like, falling in love with her mom, or at least a woman her mom's age, living what is both a very similar, but also seemingly radically different lifestyle. And maybe, I don't know if that's just the American versus immigrant, or if it's just single parent versus in a marriage being supported. I don't know what it is, but it feels like their lives diverged in many different ways, but they are, to a certain extent, also still the same person. Kind of.
When you say they, are you talking about
Jenny and the mom. Yeah.
Not Pizza Girl and the mom.
I think they're all similar in right. certain ways.
So in some ways it feels like her wanting to run away to Jenny's arms is running away to a very similar life to the life that she has now.
Yes.
It's just that it doesn't feel that way because grass is always greener.
Right.
Right.
Because I don't know that there's any situation she could be in that would be more supportive than the one she's currently in. I don't think there's anything even close. It's just a matter of she feels trapped because she probably doesn't want to be pregnant at 18 or doesn't want to be anything at 18, right? She just wants to, like...
And she's trapped by everyone else being psyched. Because, yeah. like, everyone else being as psyched as they are means that she also has to feel psyched. Because if you're 18 and you get pregnant and everyone is so supportive of you, they're like, yeah, that's so great that you're pregnant. Probably somewhere in your head you're thinking, why aren't they lamenting my lost future? Don't they think that I had potential? Don't they think that I could have gone and done all of these other things if I hadn't gotten pregnant? Which isn't to say that you can't do those things if you do get pregnant. Obviously you can. I think that our narrator's problem is partially with that. She doesn't like everyone being so psyched, because one of the things that really endears her to Jenny outside of the ponytail is that when Jenny asks her if she's excited about her pregnancy and the narrator kind of balks at it, Jenny immediately is like,
good,
yeah, you shouldn't be excited. It's not like,
or not that she clarifies, she's like, it's okay that you're not excited.
Yeah, feel how you feel.
Yeah.
You like, don't let everyone else dictate how you're supposed to feel about these things.
Because I think Jenny is both the woman she loves, but also the mom she wishes she had.
Yeah, which sucks because her own mom is actually really good and cool and nice.
Jenny is exactly the one, like, let's take you out of school, let's go somewhere. Mm-hmm. Also the one who abandons you to go see a movie. And the mom, Pizza Girl's mom, Kayla Chun-hee, is like, no, I'm always going to be there for you. Like, I'm never going to not be there, which is going to be a problem because you want me to not be there sometimes.
Right, yeah.
Although it is fun that, like, she also gets to act like a teenager. Like, when there's the 40-page chunk or whatever where they're not really speaking, like, around the birthday party, and she's like, the mom just goes to her room and just blasts music like a moody teenager, which I think is pretty cool.
Yeah, totally.
She wanted me to know that I was home. She was home and ignoring me.
My mom did that shit, too. Just, like, go to her room and play Leonard Cohen really loudly.
Hell yeah. Anything else about this? You want to talk about casting?
I think we're good. I want to hear your casting because I largely came up blank on this one.
So I spent a lot of time on Wikipedia trying to find young Asian actresses because
specifically Korean American actresses.
I was looking specifically Korean, and I found one that's not. I didn't cast a Korean, but I literally looked. There's a category in Wikipedia, and maybe I'm spending too much time here. American actresses of Korean descent, or something like that. Mm-hmm. And there's like 60. But like we were talking before, like before we started recording, you mentioned that Charlene Yee is a great choice, but she's also 38 years old or whatever.
Yeah, she's the mom. She's essentially the mom's age. Like, she would be my number one choice, largely because
her persona is that awkward girl.
I think she has the chops for it, and because we haven't really seen her. I think she's funny in the same way that Pizza Girl is funny, right? She could do the jokes. Because this is, again, like Death in Her Hands, in spite of the heavy subject matter, there's a lot of really funny stuff in this book. And I think Charlene Yee could do that, but I would also love to see Charlene Yee, like, do something that was dramatic.
Of heft.
Yeah.
The person I wound up thinking about, because I feel like this is the kind of movie, if done, I don't want to say if done right, but if done in the way that I'm sort of picturing it, is kind of a transition from, like, it's not a story for young, like, it's not like a YA story, but it's also not, like, exclusively an adult story. I feel like this is the kind of story that could kind of straddle both generations, sort of. And the actress that I settled on was Lana Condor. Do you know Lana Condor?
No.
She's the lead in To All the Boys I Loved Before, that trilogy. So she's Vietnamese. She's 24. But she plays in those movies, which are based on a series of books, she plays a Korean girl. Mm-hmm. And those are Netflix rom-com. And I think she's good in those movies, but I also feel like just the type of movies that those are, she's not able to really kind of flex her thing. So I feel like this is the kind of thing to go, and not like, you know, Vanessa Hudgens or whoever going from like Disney to Spring Breakers, but kind of like that halfway point where it's like, you've been a leading actor in something. Let's get you to be like a little bit more adult in a way that like isn't provocative but like has impact, as opposed to just like, my high school boyfriend might not love me or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So I think that she would be good.
Okay.
I would cast her in this because I'm interested to see what that actress does with the next thing that's not like a YA story.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. I would give her a chance on whatever this is.
Absolutely. Because you need essentially like someone that is the age, or at least looks the age that like Elliot Page was when
in Juno.
Did Juno. Yeah. Which is like legitimately someone who looks 16.
Right.
17, 18, whatever. And all the actors that I found were like, you know, Charlene was my, but then like Awkwafina was another one.
I had Awkwafina, who, and Greta Lee too. It just, it's tough.
But they're all in their 30s, yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. And so like they would be more suited for the mom role, but because of the way that we view them and they're still playing like 20 something year old in Hollywood, they're not like playing moms in movies yet.
They're playing Pizza Girl in 10 years.
Yeah.
They're playing someone who can't get their life together.
Yeah.
Because they're still, like, they look young, and they're cute, and they're funny, and they're frazzled. Mm-hmm. But they're not 50.
Yeah. But so, like, when we think of when we cast moms in movies, we cast 50-year-olds. Because everyone in Hollywood looks like they're 15 to 20 years younger than they actually are anyway. So it'd be weird if we were, like... Like, for the mom, it's like the first person that I thought of was like, oh, Sandra Oh. And then it's like, Sandra Oh is like 50 years old.
Part of this has to be someone who is young, because part of this is being, again, maybe the wrong word choice, but being trapped in a life that you maybe didn't choose.
You have to signify youth, not only in Pizza Girl, but in Pizza Girl's mom, so that you can see how young it is to be a grandmother.
So maybe you do cast a Charlene Yee or somebody.
I mean, someone like Jamie Chung could do it too. Jamie Chung was... she's done a lot of small stuff. She was on The Real World San Diego. No, but she is, I mean, she's an actor. She's in like that bike riding movie with Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Premium Rush.
Yeah.
Okay.
She's in a number of things. She's a pretty good actor.
Well, I think this is also just highlighting the fact that like actresses in Hollywood have an unattainable standard both ways, right?
You have to remain young for forever. And then when you hit a certain age, you're too old to play anything. And also, like, when I think of grandma, I think of, like, my grandma, who was born in, like, 1910. So, like, I don't think of, like, people my age being grandparents, you know? Because, like, my grandma was in her 80s when I was a child. It just, like, seems... Like, grandma, for me, seems like something different than what's in this book. So the idea of casting someone like Charlene Yee as a mother who's about to become a grandmother feels very strange. Who else?
I think I said this before. I think a lot of actresses could play Jenny. I had in my mind Betty Gilpin.
Okay, yeah, that's a good casting. Yeah,
because I think it's sort of like what Liberty Bell is on Glow. It's like the mom who doesn't necessarily like want to be a mom, but is a mom and also is a good mom, mm-hmm. but also wants to be more than just a mom. And just like I can see her like because she's beautiful, but I've also seen her on TV where she's like. No makeup, or, you know, TV makeup to show no makeup, but, like, hair not done and, like, baby vomit on a shirt, right? It's just, like, I can see her in that, and I think she can do both.
Yeah, that's great. That's great casting.
Thank you.
I kept thinking of Connie Britton.
Well, it's because you were watching Friday Night Lights.
Yeah, I do think...
Rewatching.
And she's such a great actor, but she is probably a little too old, right?
Because how old is she? Like, 50?
I have no idea.
I mean, she'd be great.
Yeah, so, I mean, I don't know. I it's a tough, like...
Because the other thing that we said this before when we were talking about the casting before I started recording was that Jenny is turning 39, but she's like, you probably couldn't tell. And, like, Pizza Girl lies to her. She's like, no, I would have guessed. Like, yeah. In her head, she's like, I would have thought you were, like, 45 or 50. Like, it just, you don't look 39.
Right. I mean, it could be, like, Charlize Theron would be all right, but she's maybe... Charlize Theron is distractingly beautiful,
yeah.
I think, a lot of the time.
And I don't want to undersell the casting of it or whatever, but, like, I think Jenny has to just play, like, Manic Pixie Dream Girl.
Kind of, yeah, because it's from a first-person perspective of someone who looks at her as the someone that's going to break her out of the prison of her life, right?
So she has to be, like, a 30-something or maybe early 40-something hot but not too hot actress who also can play, like, homely.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think a lot of people could do that.
Yeah, I do, too.
Do you have a director in mind?
Person that came to mind was Greg Mottola for some reason, but I think
that TV guy.
That's he did like Adventureland.
Okay,
but I kind of want someone that can do like shoot LA really beautifully. I mean, LA is the most filmed city of all time.
Have you seen Los Angeles Plays itself?
Yes. Yeah, yeah,
that's cool.
And so I was trying to think of directors that have like a real sense of geography and of
David Robert Mitchell.
Yeah, he doesn't. I don't know if he would do a type of movie like this though.
I wanted to pick a female director for this because I feel like it's such a female story.
Yeah, sure.
That the first person that came on my mind, and I don't know if she would, and I don't know if I think it'd be good because I think she's a very talented director. But I had Olivia Wilde.
Yeah, that's good because of Booksmart, right?
Because of Booksmart, and I also feel like whatever her new one is, Daddy's or something. I don't know whatever the one she fired Chaya from. I feel like it's like a kind of a more adult, but like Booksmart is that kind of thing. And I also had another sort of backup one. There is a movie. Have you seen Never Going Back?
Yeah,
directed by Augustine Frizzell. Who's doing a new movie that's a Netflix movie that's coming out this year called Last Letter from Your Lover with Felicity Jones and Shailene Woodley. And I feel like Never Going Back is that perfect kind of like raunchy girls who have to act older than they want to because just like life is like you have to get your shit together or whatever. And I feel like it's the kind of thing, like maybe it's too raunch. Like, I don't know. I'm interested because she only made the one movie, so I don't know what her style is like.
To that measure, Andrea Arnold would be interesting too. Sure. Because she has a real, there's a lot.
I gotta see Fish Tank still.
There's a lot of this book that is, again, like kind of internal, like the last book where it's just like she's driving around and she's thinking of whatever, listening to music. And so like, I don't know if you have you like been to student film festivals or anything like that?
Not really, no.
So the shittiest thing in every student film is long stretches of characters driving while listening to music.
Sure.
But it's because they don't know what they're doing. It's just like they're usually like listening to jazz. And it's just like, it's terrible. But that can be done really well.
Yeah.
When it's done well. Andrea Arnold, I think, is really good at that sort of thing. At like landscaping a movie. And she's especially good with very young actors and unknowns, which I think I would cast mostly unknowns in this movie, yeah. Except for the adults, quote unquote.
The 30-year-olds,
yeah.
I think it's interesting to hear you compare this in the filming of it to Death and Rands, because I felt like this is a much easier film to adapt, or book to adapt into a film. I feel like there's a lot more conversations, there's a lot more spoken as opposed to internalized. Even the stuff that's not spoken, that is in her head, just seeing a pregnant girl drinking beer in a shed is like, it's just so evocative. You don't need to know what she's thinking to know what she's thinking, right? Yeah. So, anybody else you cast or no? I don't think I did I?
Yeah, I don't think so either. It's a very small...
The cat from Captain Marvel. Gotta keep that streak going. They get the cat. Remember, Billy has the cat.
Flurgan?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I had the dog from... I had Vincent from Lost.
That's right, yeah.
I only wrote that down because it annoyed you last time, so I was just like, we're gonna keep it going. If you want to be a part of our... I hope you are a part of our book club. I mean, you're listening. You're already part of it to a certain extent. But if you want to contribute to the book club, we have an email address, lottery@cageclub.me. Send in your thoughts. You have in your podcast description and at cageclub.me/lottery... a full list of all the books we're covering this season. So read in any order you want. Email in lottery@cageclub.me. We'll read it on air. We got another email today from Egg. You're from your friend Egg.
Our friend Egg.
Will I ever meet Egg, do you think?
Probably not.
All right. Meg's reaction to Pizza Girl. I was surprised how much I liked this book. I finished it much quicker than Death in Her Hands, because Egg also wrote in last time. Thank you, Egg, for being our number one emailer. I felt this book really captured the NUI.
Ennui.
Oh.
You illiterate fuck.
Okay, so I'm not cutting that out. That's a word, like, I thought, I know that word, and I've seen this word. I did not know that they were the same word.
Yeah.
I felt this book really captured the ennui of life after school. God damn it. I'm dumb, but that's okay. It's fine. There's a part of me that wanted a, quote, happier ending, but the ending we got was more, quote, real, I think. One thing I do want to mention is that I feel like this book is unique in how it tells the story of a second-generation immigrant. She's not berated for getting pregnant. She's not pushed into a career. She's given the opportunity to do nothing. The book pushes back against the, quote, perfect Asian stereotype in a way that's refreshing and makes all the characters feel more real and rounded, which I think is a very astute point.
Yeah, that's a great point. There's actually very little about ethnicity in this text beyond... You know, there's some, but it doesn't play... a major role, or maybe it does. I don't.
It's one of those things where I'm not sure the full context of being Asian or being a woman in this story.
Right,
where it's like it's hard. Like I appreciate that there is meaning there, but I don't know.
Yeah, I would be curious to hear the opinion of someone with the life circumstance of Pizza Girl, like someone who was a second generation Korean American, and see like if this book really hits for them. But I agree that it does not fall into any sort of model minority stereotyping. Probably that's because I don't know that much about the life of the author, but I think Jin Kyung Frazier is Korean American, certainly, so she's probably just writing from a generalized experience.
Because what I think is also interesting to this point is there's the line in here before. I thought about how mom's first name was Chun-hee, although the minute she stepped off that plane and her feet first touched American soil, she told everyone to call her Kayla.
For sure.
And I don't think that's the experience of every immigrant. Like, I think there's a certain, like, either you don't want to come here for a certain reason or whatever, or like, I want to keep the old me here. But it seems like the mom is so accepting of her becoming pregnant because she's like, we're American, baby. Like, this is what we do now.
Yeah, I think that's the experience that I've had with... I've known a number of second-generation Asian Americans, and a lot of them are named like Barbara. and things like that, like super, like not only American names, but American, quote unquote American, like oldish American names, like names from like the 1950s that were popular back then.
Sure.
Because that embodies a Americanness or whatever.
Oh, and then Egg also emails. She closes it out. For the record, I would 100% try pepperoni and pickle pizza if I wasn't vegetarian.
Yeah. Well, Joey tried that today. How was it?
It was good. Yeah. It adds like a lightness. I had a kosher dill spear that I diced up and put on our meat lover's pizza.
I refused to put the pickle on the pizza, but I broke the agenate pork today, which I don't normally do.
I'm corrupting you.
But I'm interested in Meg saying that she wished that it had a happier ending. Because I don't... What does a happier ending for this book look like? Than
she winds up with Jenny? That doesn't feel like a happy ending.
Yeah. Like, a really interesting part of the end is when she's like, I wish I could tell you that I stopped drinking, but I didn't. I drink a little bit less,
yeah.
And I'll buy a six pack and I'll drink three and then throw the other three out. And it's like this idea of like forward progression, limiting yourself via alcohol. Although, like, if we're being realistic, the book ends where it does, it is the chances of that baby not having fetal alcohol syndrome are pretty slim, right?
Well, they even go to the doctor. Like, they go to a doctor in here, yeah. And he's just like, you need to stop what you're doing. Like, mm-hmm. This is bad. Like, it's explicitly laid out. And whether that's, you know, the author, like, wanted to clear up, like, hey, this is, in case you didn't realize, but now it's a bad idea, you know, like having a voice of authority. But it's like, yeah, like, don't do this.
So what does the Wayne's World super ultra happy ending look like?
I think this is close to it, because I think in a sadder ending, Billy leaves, the mom kicks her out. Right.
The saddest ending has her killing herself on the couch. Jenny's couch, yeah. Which is like, for a second, I was terrified of that. I was like, don't end the book that way. That would be infuriating. So I think we're as close to a happy ending as this book gets, because it's like,
yeah, what would be happier? She stops drinking.
Well, if you end the book with her having the baby and the baby's healthy.
Right.
That's the that's like the happy, happy ending. And then the ultra sad ending is suicide on the couch. And then the medium ending is sort of what we have, where she's like, I'm not okay.
She wants to get better, but she's still human.
But I'm trying.
Yeah.
Which is like, what is life if not that? If not just being like, I'm going to try to get better all the time.
Thank you, Egg. If you want to email in, lottery@cageclub.me. We're also at LotteryPod on Twitter. Patreon.com/LotteryPod if you want some nice perks. Episodes early, voting rights. And there's one other thing. What was the other thing?
I'll give you my home phone number.
Whoa.
You can have my home phone number. I'll counsel you on relationship problems. I can do very basic algebra. I can... that's really where my skills end. So anyway, yeah, if you want to call me, just join the Patreon and you can call me and I'll talk you through it.
Yeah, it's one tier, $5 a month, and you get everything. Also, we got Audible if you want to support Amazon and you want to get some free audiobooks and we get a kickback or something.
How does that work? Is there a code?
So if you go to cageclub.me/lottery, or if you go to the link tree on our Twitter page or whatever, you can find our page. There is a banner ad on the cageclub.me homepage, the hub for this podcast. You click on that, it brings you to this thing and says you can either do like the cheap one or the more expensive one. Like the one is like kind of like a Netflix all you can eat, but you don't get to keep things. I don't think it has everything. And then there's the one that's like you get one book a month or whatever for a little bit more money or whatever. I don't know. You click a picture on cageclub.me.
So I'd encourage you to get the audio Audible for 1 month for a free book and then cancel after the 1 month.
And if you're a Prime member, you get 3 free books.
Yeah, so just grab the next couple. I would say grab Duck's Newburyport, which is a book from later on in the cycle. It's over 1,000 pages, but if you listen to it while you're driving around, it'll go a lot quicker.
We're still recording these before any have come out. When we release to national acclaim and the email bag fills up, what I'm saying is get some books toward the end of this season, because those will be the ones that you'll be able to listen to and email in before we record those episodes.
Yeah.
Or just do whatever you want.
Yeah, you can. There's good books on there. Get some of those big William Gaddis books or something like that. Get The Power Broker by Robert Moses, which is like 70 hours.
Wow, really?
Yeah, it's a big one.
Also, if you didn't listen to our Death in Her Hands episode, or you read that book after we talked about it, which why would you do that? Why'd you spoil that? But whatever. You can still write in about that. We'll read that on the next one, too.
For sure.
Full season one reading list in the description for here and at cageclub.me/lottery. Bob, until next time, keep reading.
Today's crime is shoplifting.